October 19th, 2013. The Nile by Emil Ludwig. The Life Story of a River, 1937, The Viking Press, page 118. In those days, the loveliest and most famous princess of Abyssinia adorned herself with gold and jewels to ride to Jerusalem, where it was said there reigned a prince as handsome and as famous as herself, whom she was impatient to greet in person. Actually, she was the ruler of the land which later bore the splendid name of Arabia Felix. Merchants had come from Palestine to Yemen to see costly building stones and to take them, whatever the price, to their lord, who was building a temple to the glory of his god Yahweh. The mouth of that king, they said, was overflowing with story and fable, but most of all with songs of love, and none could say whether he knew more of wisdom or women. So the Queen of Sheba journeyed to King Solomon, and each found favor in the other's sight. But being a clever woman, she held him off at first and refused to lodge in his palace. When he began to pay court to her, she led the talk into the domain of wisdom, and he must perforce spend whole evenings philosophizing with the lovely woman, from whom he desired entertainment of a very different kind, for Solomon was a gentleman. When at last the day of her departure approached and the caravan of the guest was laden with truly Jewish lavishness by the king, she became aware of the growing restlessness of her host, who, for all his wisdom, now felt very foolish, and she loosed the reins of her decorum, for, with feminine logic, she argued that she could, after all, leave that next day. So she plucked up courage and told the king that she would spend her last night in his palace if he would swear not to molest her, while she, for her part, would promise to lay hands on nothing that was his. King Solomon, in his wisdom, grasped the double meaning in her words, but just to make sure, summoned his cook and told him to spice the farewell meal as he had never done before. Solomon and his son. The queen saw that her host had understood her, and when at last she was alone with him under his roof, spices and wine had done their work so well that she only needed to say to him, "I will release you from your vow, O king, if you will give me to drink." The courteous king fulfilled her wish in every way. Her departure was postponed. Now he was more than ever reluctant to let her go, and she seems to have put no difficulties in his way. But when she was with child, and as the months passed, her state became obvious to the whole court, she decided to depart, and with the song of Solomon, he seems then to have sung his swan song. It was high time for her to go, for on the way she gave birth to a son, whom she called Menelik ibn Hakim, that is, the son of wisdom, and he was very handsome. When he had come to the throne, the youth visited his father in Jerusalem, was received with great rejoicing, and sent away with great gifts from all the 12 tribes of Israel, with warriors and priests who were to give the Abyssinians thorough instruction in the Jewish religion. But hardly was Menelik gone when dismay fell upon Solomon. The Ark of the Covenant, the tables of stone on which Moses had written down the commandments of the Lord, the most holy possession of the Jews, was gone. Later, Menelik declared that his priests had stolen it without his knowledge, but any king would say so in such a situation. That is what priests and ministers are for. One thing is certain, that his father, in his wisdom, swore the high priest to secrecy and pursued the caravan himself, but it had vanished. As so often happened in those times, angels had protected the robbers who made their escape by passages under the Red Sea to their royal fortress. But Solomon had the tables copied by a good forger, and none of the Jews ever knew that from that time on, the ark that they worshipped was a fake. So busily have Arab and rabbinical legends spun their enigmas round the figure of the Queen of Sheba as Biltis and Sibyl that she even had to prophesy the cross of Christ. To this very day, the Abyssinians cling to this legend and have painted in a hundredfold on the walls of their churches. Today, they have it printed. Mingling of races. They have it printed in Paris or London and distribute it broadcast over the country. And the lovers lie first in two beds, and then in somewhat modern single one. But the Song of Solomon is obviously too gallant to have been addressed to the mother of their race. They declare that he laid it in the lap of one of Pharaoh's daughters, and strive in vain to forbid their young women and priests to read it, since they might read it together. In this amorous fashion, a dynasty was founded, which, in historic times from 800 BC to AD 800, ruled longer than any other on the Mediterranean. No wonder that a clever prince seeking in our own time to establish himself as ruler of this land proclaimed his descent from this royal house of Solomon and took the name of Menelik. What has happened since at this edge of Africa is to be understood only through the minglings of the races and cultures which approached Abyssinia over the Red Sea and through the Nubian desert. The Abyssinians know that and have themselves called their country Habish, that is, the mixture. Every state in Europe might bear the name of Habish. For the conquering and trading peoples of antiquity were always drawn to the land which contained gold, ivory, and slaves. Which races supplanted which, how far the Hamitic peoples pushed the Semitic southwards, such things are uncertain, and are merely a parlor game for professors. The Ethiopians seem only once to have invaded a foreign civilization when, about 730 BC, they conquered Egypt, bringing back with them later many Egyptian gods and customs. The Greeks called this country and its neighbor Kush by the general name of Ethiopia, the name it again bears today, became mixed with Jewish and Arab elements, Aksum, the remains of which were recently excavated in the north of Abyssinia, for a long time ruled Arabia too. To complete the confusion of cultures, a Jewish Arab king about AD 300 called himself Son of Ares. This scion of the Greek gods was the first to be baptized, obviously in expiation. Thus the Son of Ares wore the legendary three rings on his finger before the legend came into being. For the Abyssinians became Christians long before most of the white peoples, and the curious fact that these brown races possess today a Christian cult, the Falashas, 15 centuries old, provides a unique opportunity for inquiring how far they have reached a higher stage of moral development than their heathen and Mohammedan neighbors. Beset on both sides, the young Christianity wavered. When the Abyssinian Christians threatened Mecca, they were repulsed in the very year of Muhammad's birth. Soon after, they had to withdraw from southern Arabia on account of smallpox, one of the few cases in history in which a pestilence has involved worldwide political consequences. At that point, the struggle between the two religions began. Meanwhile, in this Greek-Arab-Christian chorus, the Jews raised their voice and in devoured from the 6th century on to re-establish their religion in Abyssinia, long after the Greek Ethiopians are believed to have embraced the Jewish faith. This was carried out not by missionaries, but by the influence of nomads transmitting their customs to other nomads, while they called themselves Falasha, that is, the misunderstood. The Jew grew strong. In the 9th century, history took an ironic turn, for which documentary evidence again exists. A Jewish princess in Abyssinia drove out the dynasty descended from Solomon, which had later become Christian, and under the name of Queen Judith, made herself mistress of the north. Not for 400 years till about 1260 did a Christian prince of the south, who traced his descent from Menelik and Solomon, succeed in conquering the descendants of Judith. And the new king dropped his lust of power and his jealousies with anti-Semitic speeches, just as if he had lived 700 years later. In bestowing upon themselves the title of archpriest, these Christian kings made themselves no whit better than Judith. The kaleidoscope of their history in the next few centuries turns in bewildering pictures. Conquered queens were hacked to pieces and thrown to the dogs, and after their death, the monks walked in public procession. There were chaste living clerics who compensated themselves with wine and roast meat, invaded heathen chiefs, feasted with them, and then had their hosts slaughtered by their slaves. And all these were Christians, proud of their faith, who boasted of being the oldest sect. Chapter 5, page 122. At first, Abyssinia was believed to be the land of paradise. Even Josephus acknowledged the Nile to be one of the two biblical rivers. But since after the fall, gold and power became men's chief motive. The nation came hither seeking gold and slaves. The land had no defense save mountains and rain, while in the plains of the Sudan, princes and dynasties, in the course of the ages, succumbed again and again to foreign marauders. The land of mountain fatness, like Switzerland, held all at bay. Here the rain swept away roads and armies for the land, save at the point, falls steeply even to the Red Sea, where since prehistoric times the commerce of the world has streamed past. Thus all the empires which flourished in Africa between 10 degrees and 15 degrees north latitude, only one remained, the country of the Blue Nile, a natural fortress. From the ancient Egyptians to the traders of today, men came here seeking incense and ivory, gold and slaves. Abyssinian ivory goes back in Egypt even to prehistoric times. In the train of the merchants, three religions and four or five different civilizations spread light and chaos through these steep and narrow mountain valleys. But if they tried to conquer the country, mountains, precipices and rivers, men and rain united to expel the intruders. Yet the same elements split this empire up into so many separate lands that no one has ever been able to rule it as a whole. The princes are perpetually at war with each other and compel every man to be a soldier. If no one could conquer this strange empire from the outside, no one could govern it within. Disunited and impregnable, encircled by desire and curiosity, the natural fortress rises like a humped shoulder at the edge of the continent. Courted by the white powers which govern its neighbors, for it conceals within it the sources of the mystery river, which yet, as we shall see later, is innocent of all the legend woven round it. Attacks on Abyssinia. Historical documents stretching back thousands of years tell of all the conquering strangers who were driven out of Abyssinia. From the oldest reports on papyrus of Egyptian journeys and landings on the Red Sea to the stone tablets recording the treaties of the Queen of Sheba, from the obelisk of the Ethiopians, which were raised 1,000 years before Christ by methods we cannot even imagine, to Herodotus, who tells in a fable of the treasures of Abyssinia. Here Roman emperors caught elephants to perform for the amusement of the people, and Byzantine emperors bartered worthless things for gold. In ancient history, one white people after the other penetrated into those inaccessible and pathless regions, yet none remained, and native princes ruled with hardly an exception from Solomon's day to our own. Even later, the great seafaring peoples succeeded only in establishing trade here. Venice drove the Arabs from the Red Sea coast so that they had once more to carry the gold and ivory of Abyssinia through the desert on camels. The only memorial left behind by this strongest sea power of its time was the bad pictures of an adventurer who was hailed here as a second Titan because he came from Venice. Even today, the traveler is struck by the Italian style of their crude sacred pictures. Once in distress, an Abyssinian Negus emperor and archpriest recalled his Christian descent and called on the Pope for help against the infidels. The Pope confined himself to a fine Latin letter, which nobody in Abyssinia could read, and gave the pious Moors a church in Rome, which 8 centuries later is still called San Stefano dei Mori. Later Abyssinian pilgrims in Jerusalem heard that the mightiest Christian of the time was a king of Portugal, but when the glittering embassy reached his court, he turned his back on the Negroes, not trusting their Christianity. So deep was the darkness in which the Abyssinians lived 3 centuries after their entry into Rome. Not until the next century did the Christian brothers embrace, and he who was powerful promised help to the oppressed. In the meantime, the Portuguese had not only heard that in that dubious Moorish land there were ivory and slaves to be had for nothing, conquerors and priests. But heresy also told that the very earth there consisted of 2 parts of gold to 1 of soil. And though the king thought that must be an exaggeration, he hoped perhaps for 1 part of gold to 2 of soil. At first, the Portuguese had to pay dearly for their adventures. When they advanced from the Red Sea to help the king against the Arabs, who had spread over half Abyssinia from Egypt, converting it to Islam by force, not only was of their noblest knights, the son of Vasco da Gama, captured and tortured, but his victorious enemy beheaded him afterwards with his own hands. The conquered Christians were castrated to a man. This happened in 1541. Centuries were to pass before a Christian king was to have a literal revenge, member for member. 2 years later, the Portuguese were victorious and restored the Abyssinian king. How was King Claudius to show his gratitude now? By way of thanks, he decided to have himself baptized in a slightly different form by adopting the Catholic ritual, and thus conjured up fresh struggles. Portuguese scientists and merchants remained in the country. The procedure of former kings had been never to let an ambassador go, but to pay him in women and treasure for advice of priceless value, and thus, in the most graceful way, to hold him prisoner. Then, north of Lake Tana, the Portuguese built the fortress and city of Gondar, with huge round towers and frowning walls like those in Toledo, which are the only bit of Europe outside of the modern capital to stand out from the Negroid architecture of the empire. But it seemed the inevitable fate of this wild mountain land to be rent by religious warfare, whose storms tore as much away from the natural fortress as the rain and the Nile. Roman Jesuits sent out by the Pope went restlessly about the land in quest of power. On the confines of the Christian world, among half Negroes, the struggle for the teachings of Christ began at the same time and with the same passion as in Europe. When the Mohammedan menace had disappeared, the Christians decided to fall upon each other. Why did these Arab Jewish chiefs, whose churches were huts and whose religious ceremonies were drums and shrieks, batter each other's head in? Jesus was anointed by the Holy Spirit, but he did not need it. Wrong, cried the antagonist, an Abyssinian Napoleon. His dual nature was first made one by this anointment. Wrong again, cried yet others. He could fulfill the redemption only through the Holy Spirit. At times, all 3 sects united in the cry, kill the Jews. Then they again fell apart, and in the very year, 1630, in which Gustavus Adolphus, Wallenstein, and Tilly were driving Christians before their guns, each in the delusion that he possessed the true Christ, Coptic and Catholic priests in Abyssinia were setting loose their flocks on each other with sword and lance for the interpretation of the same doctrine. In these sectarian disputes, the empire fell apart, just as did the German Empire at the same time. The heathen Gala, a mixed race of Negroes, Hamites, and Arabs, invaded the country from the south. The capital shifted about continuously in rebellions and dynastic changes. The Negus and Gondar became a shadow. Every prince ruled with his own mailed fist. if not with his own head. 2 centuries of anarchy were brought to an end in 1850 by an adventurer, Casa, who began as a bandit chief like the Homeric heroes and modern dictators, and who, to provide for all contingencies, took the title of Negus Negesht, or King of Kings, and at the same time the name of Theodore, the Christian archpriest who began by trading in Cuso, the remedy for tapeworm, then rose as rapidly from robber chief to emperor as Napoleon, from lieutenant to emperor, also recalls certain phenomena of our time in that he lost his head in gaining power, settled down to be a monster, killed all who stood in his way, and finally forced the patriarch to consecrate him at the point of a pistol. The death of his second wife plunged him into gloom, and as his third was merely the daughter of a powerful prince, he consoled himself with a beautiful Gala woman, as both the slender woman had to accompany him on all his campaigns. Their tents stood at equal distances on each side of his scarlet imperial tent, but on the march, just to make sure, the rivals rode half an hour apart. The only Europeans whom Theodore acknowledged were the English, because he wanted their help against the Egyptians. His friendship for the Englishmen was so intense that to avenge their death in one of his battles, he had hundreds of prisoners beheaded. Suicide of Negus Negesht. But as the Irish hunter and the Scottish consul were, after all, dead, he could see only one figure in England worthy of him, namely the Queen, for she had just become a widow, and would assuredly be glad to strengthen her power over a number of dark races by a union with the most powerful emperor in Africa. In 1862, without further ado, he sent her an offer of marriage. The incredible happened. The letter remained unanswered. It was hardly to be expected that the mightiest of emperors was going to suffer the affront. The Negus was beside himself and had the English ambassador, Cameron, cast into prison and chained to a common criminal. Now, for the first time, a great white power took the field against Abyssinia. The English punitive expedition advanced, besieged the King of Kings in his fort, and demanded the release of the prisoner. But then the adventurer recalled his bold beginnings. He shot himself, and by this resolute gesture won the respect of posterity for his character, for at least he knew how to pay up. Chapter 6, page 127. It was the mountains which made warriors of the Abyssinians. For thousands of years, the rain has interrupted every war. In Abyssinia, hate can flourish only from October to May. With the help of these two elements, this half-savage mountain people even made it a successful stand against the second latest technique of warfare. In the 70s and 90s, they inflicted a crushing defeat on two peoples equipped with modern arms, first Egypt 3 times, then Italy, driving them from the country. When in 1885 the Sudan was in the hands of the Mahdi, Egypt fully occupied and Abyssinia threatened by the Mahdi's followers, it was easy for Italy to assume the role of protector of the country with the object of securing, at the last moment, a precious lump of the great black cake. The embroilments of the great powers even then seemed to be deciding the fate of Abyssinia. No one believed it could hold out. But when the last emperor had fallen on the frontier fighting against the Mahdi, one of his most powerful vassals had proclaimed himself emperor, and as he had at that moment good reason to dread the power of the Mahdist, he preferred to cede to Italy a certain amount of territory with a general protectorate. This remarkable man had learned from the white tribes that it is the proper thing to have a noble lineage attested by the competent authorities, and hence took the name of Menelik II, as the blood descendant of the first Menelik, who, 3,000 years before, had, like Euphorion, inherited the beauty of the Arab Helen with the wisdom of the Jewish Faust. This second Menelik was, it is true, rather cunning than wise, and though he was handsome, All the same, there was something of the lion about him. Neither Semitic nor Negro features distinguished him in his bluntness from a Nordic type. And if the big lower lip on his portrait is covered, he looks like some robust Scandinavian whose eyes might have been gray-blue. Less cruel, more rustic, more sensible than his countrymen and peers, thoughtful and humorous, his manners have little in common with those of his predecessors. His hands and handwriting were equally beautiful, so far as the Amharic letters can be judged. In his youth, as the son of a mighty prince, he had sought to legitimate himself in every possible way, having at the age of 45 taken the reins of power into his hands. He made his rival his friends by giving him his daughter to wife, and turned for support to the priest, about whom he had no illusions. As the Negus is master of all the possessions of his subjects, a kind of reversed communism, he let the princes go on stealing as they liked, altered nothing at the head of the state and very little below, and drew his innovations rather from his inborn common sense than from the imitation of the whites, from whom he adopted little except the army. He tolerated no prisons, because I will not have criminals fed at the expense of honest men, quickly forgotten and never seen. He had the less serious offenders flogged, the more serious mutilated on the face of their genitals, so that they should go about as a scandal and a warning. In his new capital, Addis Abeba, he would often, on a Sunday, entertain 3,000 or 4,000 of his subjects, mostly soldiers, distributing among them 10,000 loaves, 500 gallons of mead, and 200 oxen.